Around the world, millions of people exchange goods, information, and technology at a faster rate than ever before imagined. The number of people studying abroad and immigrating for higher-paying jobs has increased dramatically. Fresh fruit, even in wintertime, it's available from warmer climates around the world. Globalization may offer opportunities the world has never seen before, but not everyone benefits from having the world within reach. Perched on the side of a mountain in southern Mexico, the town of Tilapia has seen its share of hard times. Coffee has been its primary source of income for years, but the people of Tilapia didn't anticipate that the world coffee prices would collapse.
When the price of coffee falls, it affects all of us because there isn't money. There isn't money, not for us, not for the children.
It was the government itself that motivated the planting of coffee.
Obviamente que eso fue una gran sorpresa positiva para.
This was a positive surprise for the indigenous and farmers, because it was a market that was just opening. And the result of the first harvest was that they had high profits. But nobody told them that coffee depends on an international price.
They don't have anywhere to take the coffee anymore. That is what the woman from here told me. They are throwing it away because it has no value, because it isn't any good anymore. We are the ones who are ruined because we are working so that others can profit. That is the problem.
Sometimes the people do not harvest their coffee because it doesn't make enough to pay the laborers. They leave the coffee right there to rot. It is ruined. Everyone is ruined. There is no corn. There isn't any sustenance. Sometimes the children go to school without eating because there is nothing. If there were money, a good price for coffee, then yes, we would struggle on. If they continue their study, that is the only hope. But while there isn't a good price, we don't achieve anything.
From the 1960s through the 1980s, the International Coffee Agreement, or ICA, regulated prices and imposed quotas on its producers. In 1989, the U.S. pulled out of the ICA because it felt that regulated coffee prices were no longer in its best interest. The failure of the ICA and the subsequent association of coffee-producing countries was due in part to lack of worldwide participation. Without quotas and price control, production soared and prices fell. Coffee farmers were completely at the mercy of the market, where supply quickly outgrew demand. That was good news for big companies that owned coffee brands like Nescafe and Maxwell House. The oversupply meant they could bid producers against each other, driving prices for raw beans lower and lower. Over 90% of coffee profits now go to processors and retailers, leaving little for the farmers who work the fields.
The market is perverse. It attracts you, charms you, but in the end it betrays you. There are no feelings in the market, no values.
For some fortunate coffee-growing communities, fair trade companies like Equal Exchange have partnered with them to alleviate the harsh reality of the market by offering a guaranteed minimum price for coffee, regardless of the market price, and cutting out the middleman. Equal Exchange offers coffee farmers a fair share of the profits. But the people of Tilapia are still waiting for fair trade practices to reach their remote village.
I do see fair trade as an alternative, but it is a vulnerable alternative that depends very much on whether I am known or not known, on whether by chance someone came here and passed through Tilapia and said, "Listen, I can buy your coffee."
Where governments once would have stepped in to alleviate poverty and offer assistance to their farmers, their hands are now tied by trying to compete in the global marketplace. How did this happen? In 1989, the Berlin Wall fell, signaling the end of the Cold War. Into the vacuum of power left by failed communist economies, the free market entered with a vengeance. In most countries around the world, government control of the market was out, and the free market was in. The new law of the land was that markets rule. Many international leaders saw the free market as the only way to sustain economic growth and open their borders to international investors and businesses. But not everyone benefited from the abrupt change from state protectionism to the eat-or-be-eaten free market. Some had the education and connections to capitalize on the opportunities and profited handsomely. But many were not prepared for the new rules of the market that valued efficiency and innovation and disregarded tradition and any social safety net. Small-scale producers like most Mexican farmers see little benefit from free market globalization.
The great deceit of the globalizing model is that the only things spoken about are macroeconomic indicators that never get to the stomach of the farmer and the indigenous. We see how the entrance into globalization signifies the opposite for the indigenous peoples: more backwardness, more hunger, more violence, more suffering.
Saturnino Garcia Reyes is a corn farmer in the state of Guerrero, Mexico. He and the other farmers in the town of Zacongo have always relied on corn as a staple in their diet. In good years, they've been able to sell some of the excess corn to buy other necessities.
My father was the one who taught us how to cultivate the fields, because only from them could we live. He always told us that in order to eat, one must work. And corn is the only thing that produces. It is the basic food that we have here. With respect to corn, the population of this region, as in all Mesoamerica, is characterized for its dependence on corn as the principal product of their diet. The production of corn is the most important in the family economy, even though the lands are not suitable for the production of corn.
To diminish the impact of poor soil and a harsh climate for farming in Guerrero, the Mexican government offered financial assistance to farmers, but were restricted by International Monetary Fund regulations. Caught in the middle between IMF pressure and the farmers' needs, the Mexican government encouraged farmers to update their farming practices. These included planting disease-resistant hybrid corn and using chemical fertilizers to increase the yield of the crops. While the short-term benefits of increased productivity were immediately evident, farmers eventually started to experience the negative side.
Before, in other times, they always used organic fertilizers, and the organics are what maintain the earth. As soon as we started to use chemical fertilizers, the land started to deteriorate as well. If we don't use chemical fertilizers in these days, the planting doesn't produce. That is to say, one needs to use a chemical fertilizer to have a harvest. The introduction of improved seeds, fungicides, herbicides, more agricultural tools and machinery, these really benefit the big industries of the city more than the farmers themselves.
The fact that farmers were now buying seed and fertilizers meant that more money was changing hands. In macroeconomic terms, this counted as progress for the Mexican economy. But to the farmer, it looks different. The high costs of hybrid seeds and fertilizers are hard to pay for when the market for corn disappears. It's not that the Mexican people were eating less corn. Rather, the United States government was subsidizing large corn farmers and agribusinesses in the U.S., allowing them to sell corn at